Dobar den. Blagodaria for coming. And there's one more phrase I know in Bulgarian, that's obichante. Is that? I'm not sure if that's the right word to use here, though. My name's Heinz. I live on the island of Crete. And I flew over this morning. I'm a German, Dutch, South African, Greek. I have lots and lots of Bulgarian friends in Crete. They come there to pick oranges and are fantastic people. They come mostly from the area of Stara Zagora and Nova Zagora, Panichev, Revo. So I've got loads and loads of people there that I know and that know me. But I don't think many of them are Java programmers. They're mostly orange pickers. So I started the Java Specialist newsletter many, many years ago. It's now read in 134 countries, and I've met quite a few people here already who read my newsletter. So thank you very much. I appreciate it. Because of that, I became a Java champion about 10 years ago. And I also managed to weasel my way into a Java 1 Rockstar Award. I'll tell you that one day, how that happens. So we're going to talk about concurrency. And concurrency is a tricky one, because if you get it half right, it's completely wrong. You can't do a half job. You have to do the synchronization in exactly the right place. If you get it slightly wrong, you end up with deadlocks, race conditions. If you have too much synchronization, you end up with all sorts of problems. Too little, you also have problems. So either way, you have a problem. The best is not to do it. So if you can avoid concurrency, avoid it. Right? But you can't always avoid it, because there are certain classes of problems where we need to understand how it works in order to get the best performance out of our systems. So what I did was I put together a whole bunch of different laws. I tried to make them as colorful as possible, so maybe you can remember some of them. For example, the law of the corrupt politician. Do you have corrupt politicians in Bulgaria? No, not here, nothing. We only have those in Greece, not in Bulgaria, of course. The law of Cretan driving, I think you'll like that. You know those white stripes across the road? Do they mean anything in Bulgaria? Sometimes? Okay. In Greece, they mean go faster. So just if you come to Crete, you know, you're warned. All right, the first one is the law of the sabotage doorbell. Now, this one relates back to when I was living in South Africa, and we had a doorbell, and this doorbell was, people kept on ringing it. They were doing all sorts of, you know, selling newspapers or brooms or something, and they would wake up the dog would bark, wake up the baby, and if you've ever had a baby, you know that you don't want the baby to wake up if it's busy sleeping. Everybody's miserable at the end of that. So I solved the problem by removing the batteries from the doorbell. And after that, I didn't get any more interruptions. I just took away all the interruptions in one. Of course, when my mother-in-law came to visit, she couldn't get in. That was actually part of the plan, but don't tell her that. Recording off. She might watch this. All right. So you might have seen code like this, right? You see there, try thread.sleep 1000, and then catch interrupted exception. And maybe if you're lucky, there's a comment that says, that's not going to happen here anyway. Maybe they've put in a print stack trace. And I see this type of code all the time. And so we're going to answer the question, what does this actually mean when you see interrupted exception, and how should we handle it? Now, this is a surprisingly simple question with a surprisingly complex answer. All right? The answer is not easy at all. Now, originally, interruptions were built like software-hardware interrupts. You know, it basically just says, stop doing what you're doing and do something else. Not exactly sure what you're going to do, but you're going to do something else. And we have started using it in many different contexts in order to shut down a thread which we don't want to use anymore. That's not the actual reason for having it, but that's what we use it for nowadays. And the idea is that we shut down at a time when we're not busy with something really important. So, for example, if you're busy sleeping, well, you know, you're not doing any very important calculation, so that's a good time to interrupt you so you can exit. And there are lots of methods which throw interrupted exception. Now, prior to Java 5, the only ones you really had were wait and sleep. But when Java 5 came around, all of a sudden there were a whole bunch of methods which all threw this exception. And so we came into contact with it far more, but most people still didn't know what to do with it. And so how the status comes about is you can interrupt a thread that's busy running with interrupt method. And this sets the status to true, that's actually somewhere on the C layer, and if the thread is currently in the waiting or time waiting state, it returns immediately with an interrupted exception. So it's a way to say, stop what you're doing and do something else. You don't actually say shut down, you just say stop what you're doing and do something else. And if the thread is not currently in one of those two states, it will simply continue running, and in that state, it will actually continue processing, so you're not stopping the thread, you're just saying, hey, listen, I'm changing a flag to be true, and when you get to the next timed situation, please, would you exit? Now, the different ways that you can deal with this, the first one is to simply rethrow interrupted exception. That's sort of passing the buck, as we say in English. We simply make it somebody else's problem. And that's actually a good approach in many, many cases. Of course, you can't always do it. For example, if you're overriding a method which doesn't allow you to throw it, like a runnable.run, then it won't work. But in many other cases, it can be so. Now, a second option is to catch it and then return. But what you want to do there is you don't want to actually lose that status, because the thread that's, or the method that's called you actually wants to, might need this information in order to do some processing. So we don't want to lose it. We actually want to we want to remember that. So the way to do it is to re-interrupt yourself and then return. Now you have to return. If you don't return, you can end up with a live lock inside your code. Also, something you might want to do is to have a volatile running field as a backup mechanism in case the code that you call somehow swallows this exception. So I was sitting over there early on when Jeremy was talking. It was a fantastic talk on Jcash. And he put up the slide, and I thought, quickly take a picture. Now, I'm short-sighted, so I can't really read what was on the screen. But when I looked at it afterwards, I realized that, much to my surprise, nothing to do with you, the code is actually correct. Most of the time when you see somebody put up a sleep, it's incorrect, and they're swallowing the exception. But here, Jaromir is catching it, and he's doing the most reasonable thing in the circumstance, which is to re-interrupt the thread and pass that status on to the caller. Right? Now, the other ways you could deal with it, for example, you could maybe save the information for later and then return, or you could throw some other type of exception. But this is it's actually a good approach in this particular circumstance. Now, the second one is the law of the Xerox copier, you know, the photocopy machine. And the idea is that you don't give the originals, you give copies of the objects, so that if somebody changes the copy, it's no problem. So there's a little story here. When we moved to Greece, we had no credit rating. You know, that's a problem. If you try and buy anything on credit, you don't have a credit rating, it's a problem, right? It's okay if you owe some money, but if you don't owe any money, that's a problem. So we handed in our application forms for a home loan to this bank called Eurobank, which I'm sure you've had here too. And the documents came back from Athens, and the night when the documents came back, this is what happened to the bank where I have my account, or had my account, right? Now, I didn't do that, just by the way. Other people did that, but it happened to be exactly the same time as when my documents were lying on the desk. They're probably somewhere in the trash there. There was a riot, and the rioters went into the bank and just trashed it. Luckily, I only gave copies of my important documents to the bank. So the fact that they were trashed with a big stamp on top saying denied doesn't really bother me, because they're only copies. If there were some originals, I would have a real problem now, because they would have been destroyed in that riot. Immutable objects are always thread safe. You don't have to worry about thread safety because they can't change. They don't have mutable state. And a lot of the clever approaches to solving concurrency issues work together with immutable objects. Now, in terms of concurrency, immutable means that the state cannot be modified after construction. The fields are final, and you don't let this escape during construction. For example, if you add yourself as a listener somewhere, you're letting this escape. There are many ways you can let this escape. Even with lambdas, you could let this escape accidentally without realizing it. So you should be careful with using lambdas inside a constructor if you want to make an immutable object. So you might wonder, well, how can you use it? Well, in many places we use this, for example, with strings. Well, strings aren't actually immutable because they change the hash code, but that's another discussion. But whenever you change a string, it makes a copy of the string and makes a new string. Now, this has additional garbage collection expense. Now, that, of course, is a problem because garbage collection is a very big cost in many applications, especially if you're working in financial trading or something like that. You want to avoid GC as much as possible. So it's not always a solution that's going to work for you. But I wrote an array list which was mutable, just for fun, just to see what it would look like, to give you some ideas of how the principle would work. And it's a bit like this. You've got here an immutable array list. I construct it with an empty object array. And every time I change it, I make a new array. Right? Now, of course, this is going to be a problem if I make very large arrays. Right? A better approach would be to have a linked list, an immutable linked list structure. Because with a linked list structure, you can just add it as a chain, element in the chain. So this is just an idea, just not production code, just to show you the principle here. And the iterator would then have has next and next. Both of these are, don't have to worry about concurrent modification exception because you can't have a concurrent modification. And then remove, of course, won't be supported, which is a reasonable thing to do. Now, the way that this would work is you would call add, and that would return the new immutable array list. And so it's add, 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 and eventually you'd end up with a new array list which is now immutable, and you can use it safely for multiple threads without worrying about somebody else modifying that particular instance. That's sort of the idea, making copies of objects. Now, the next little law is the law of the overstocked haberdashery. Who knows what a haberdashery is? Oh, it actually says there, okay. It's a shop that sells threads and needles. That's what haberdashery is in English, in the UK and South Africa. In America, haberdashery is a shop that sells hats. So it's a completely different meaning, but I'm talking about the UK version. So I'll tell you a story here. I had a customer in South Africa, and the company was run by a guy who used to be a professor at university, engineering or computer science or something. I think engineering. And so I spoke to him on the phone before I went to see the company, and on the phone, I told them what their problem was, and I told them the solution for their problem. And the problem was that they had a client-side library running on the server, because it was easier to code. Every time that a connection came in, they created 5 threads. Right? You can see where this problem is going. So every time a client connected, it's 5 threads gone. And I said to him on the phone, it's not going to work. You can't scale. And he said, no, you don't know anything. You can have millions of threads, it's no problem. Of course, in theory, you can, right? And his PhD probably was about you can, but you can't, okay? You can't. It's not going to work. And so I went in there, and one of the mistakes I made, this is a tip for all of those who want to become consultants one day, my asking price per hour was too low. Because my price was too low, instead of accepting what I was saying, he argued about my price being too high. All right? You might have experienced that. So he didn't listen to me. He said, no, your price is too high. If I'd come with like 10 times the amount, like, okay, it's 5,000 euros, you know, per hour, then you got like, whoa, this guy must be very, very hot, you know? And every word I say, like, write it down and do it. And he would have saved money that way if he just listened to me in the first place. But he didn't. So eventually, I couldn't get through to him, so what I did was I did the following. I'll do a quick demo for you. So I'll just quickly put this on. Yeah, lots of threads, .java, public, class, lots of threads. This is what I did because I was logged into the machine. So I was like on a terminal on the machine. So it's VI all the way. Public static void main string args. And I just made an atomic integer, so final atomic integer. I knew it wouldn't need a long. number equals new atomic integer. And of course, we have to import that. So it's import java.util.atomic.star. And then what I did was I simply constructed new threads until we ran out of threads. So I would say something like new thread. And in the run method, so we'd have public void run. I just print out the number. So I'd say system.out.println, number.increment, and get. And then I would sleep for a long time. So here we'd have to do the whole try-catch, try thread.sleep for a very, 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 very long time, longer than we have time for, and then catch interrupted exception. I'll be good over here, and I'll actually re-interrupt myself. Although in this case, we actually are at the top of the thread hierarchy, so we can safely just exit. So, but I'm going to just be the, in fact, we're on the current thread, we can just say interrupt and return, just to be pedantic about this. And then we say close brace here, dot start, and there. Okay. So I ran this code for him, and it doesn't work because I got them something. Atomics. Concurrent.atomics, of course. Dot concurrent.atomic. So it happens when you code out of your memory. And I need to also do a for loop while true around there. So we have a while true. I was coding it a bit more elegantly in front of the guy, but there we go. And boom. Okay. And it crashed. It said unable to create new native thread after some limit. And his words to me were, Java's stupid. Okay. So I was like, shake amazing. I mean, this, I said, please, this is not going to work. You've got to use a different library. And then eventually they did it, and then they managed to scale to millions and millions and millions of customers, eventually, after some more work. So you can see that we run out of threads pretty quickly. This is a Mac OS X restriction. You can't make more than 2,048 threads per process. Of course, you could start lots of processes, but essentially you're going to be limited by the number of threads that your operating system allows. This is what actually happened on their machine, is it crashed completely, did a core dump, and you sometimes have to kill them with -9 once you run out of threads. You can't even connect to it anymore. What's also fun is that once you run out of threads, you also can't connect with something like jConsole, because that needs threads to be able to connect to it. So it causes all sorts of problems. Now, one thing that we can do when we have lots of threads is to use thread dumps with control break on Windows, control backslash on Unix, or you can have also a thread dump JSP page. I wrote one a long time ago. The question is, how many threads should you have? This is a scaling question. You don't want to have too many threads, unnecessary threads. It makes debugging that much more complicated and difficult. Anything from about 4 per core, active threads per core, inactive threads, not too many, because they consume memory, and they also make it very, very hard to debug your system. Now, another thing that we can do is to use thread pools. Thread pools help to control the number. It's sort of a traffic calming effect. That's the benefit we have, rather than just getting smaller latency. Because your latency is not really going to go down if you first have to go wait in the queue. Because often, if the thread pool is under stress, there's going to be a queue of events, a queue of jobs that have to be done anyway. So before you can get to the front of the queue, you have to wait. So for latency's sake, executed services is not always going to be better. Sometimes it's going to be much worse than just constructing your thread directly. All right. Now, the next one's a law of the blind spot. So when I lived in South Africa many years ago, one of the things I did was I bought myself a nice Alfa Romeo 2-litre, twin spark, 156, fantastic car. And the first thing I did was I was next to a Mercedes-Benz at the traffic light, and I accelerated. Accidentally, I got my accelerator caught underneath the floor mat. right? So I was screaming, "Rrrr!" And the Merc driver must have thought, what an idiot. I mean, come on, okay, he's got a cool car, but really, you know, does he have to show off like that? And I was like, "Ah!" trying to get this thing to stop. And then I was on the highway, you know, this new car and power steering, all this cool stuff, and there was a car next to me. I didn't see it. I almost wrote him off. I think it was the second day I had the car. So, yeah, that was interesting. The blind spot. If a car's in your blind spot, you can't see it. And similarly, what can happen with threads is you can have memory and data can be stored inside something which you can't see the change. So the idea is that Java memory is quite expensive to access. You know, the main memory. If you've got to go all the way down to the RAM, it's really expensive. So what we try and do is to avoid that by caching as much as possible and allowing all the layers to cache. You've got level one cache, level two cache. Java can cache information inside the stacks as well. And this we do in order to make our system reasonably fast. If we don't allow any caching, we're going to always have the worst possible performance. So I've got a class runner here, private boolean running equals true. And I've got a method called doJob, and it says while running, or do something. Now, the problem is that if somebody calls shutdown, they are going to change the actual field. But the thread which is called doJob might never see that change. I'm talking about never until you restart the virtual machine. And the challenge with that is that if you debug the code, then in the debugger, it will actually show it. But in that production code, it won't show it. So it's very, very tricky. Different ways to prevent it, you can make the field volatile. If you make it volatile, then it won't cache it anyway, and it's always going to go to main memory to fetch the data. Now, you can imagine that that's expensive, and you're right, it is expensive. But at least it's going to be correct. Final also helps, but not in this particular case, because you do want to change it, so we can ignore that for now. We can also make the reads and writes synchronized, and that includes the new Java 5 locks, and we'll talk about the new 5 locks in a moment. So this is the corrected solution. I've now got a private volatile boolean running, and now I don't have to worry about that not reading the most up-to-date value anymore. You're being fired tomorrow. You just don't know it, okay? Your boss has decided you're being kicked out, the whole camp, all the programmers, outsourced to India. Okay? All of you, gone. You just haven't heard it. Because there's a memo that's been written by hand, and that's in the photocopy machine. Now, you don't know it, so you're not going to cause any damage. Again, just tomorrow when you arrive back at work, and you're like, sorry, man, there's your stuff. You know? And but you're not supposed to know this. But what could have happened is that the secretary might have seen that memo. Because the boss, of course, doesn't really know how to use a photocopy machine, so he's left the original lying there. And so you now see a state that you shouldn't have seen before. Okay? And this is now something from the Java memory model. If you look here, I've got two fields, X and Y, and I've got a method F and a method G. Now, you can see that inside the method F, I first say A equals X, and then I say y equals 3, and afterwards I say b equals y and x equals 4. So two different mechanisms. Now, what can happen is, it might happen if you call the two methods at the same time, they'd end up with a equals 4 and b equals 3. You can see some shocked faces around here. It doesn't make any sense. How can that happen? You see, from a single-threaded perspective, it doesn't matter if you reorder A equals X and Y equals 3. It doesn't make a difference. You can first say Y equals 3 and then A equals X, and that's going to be equivalent to saying A equals X and then Y equals 3. Those statements are not related. And if the pipeline calculation is such that it's better to do it the other way around, then that's fine. So. But from a multi-threaded perspective, of course, it does matter in which order you allow this. This is, by definition, allowed, this reordering. So by definition, they explicitly allow the code to be reordered. And this, it's important also because this can also happen on the hardware level as well, not only within Java. The way that we can prevent it is by adding a synchronized block. If you put a synchronized block around the F and G, then then you either have A equals, what was it again? You either have A equals 4 or Y equals 3, or you have, so either those two, or you can make it volatile. Volatile also prevents happens, these early writes by doing what we call a happens before edge. So you also prevent that from happening. Now, the other problems I've talked about, I can easily reproduce with some demo code. And so I was speaking to a friend of mine, Victor Grazzi, who wrote the Java Concurrent Animator tutorial. It's a really nice tutorial to show you animations about how the concurrency constructs work. And I said to him, I can't demonstrate this. He said, it's very easy. Here's what you do. You simply ignore the fact that the code can be reordered. Then you write some production code that depends on that. You test it. Of course, all your tests will pass. And then you release the production. You wait for feature freeze. And then check your inbox. And you'll have 500 emails from customers who've had this problem. Okay? Now, the law of the corrupt politician. In the absence of proper controls, corruption is unavoidable. And Lord Acton says, power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So here I've got a bank account, and there's a balance inside, a field balance, and I've got a little deposit method says balance plus equals amount, and withdraw says deposit minus amount. And what can happen is, because plus equals is not atomic, thread 1 and thread 2 can both read 1,000 onto their stack. Then they update it locally on their stack. When they write it out, oops, just making sure you're awake. When they write it out, they overwrite each other's values. Now, prior to Java 5, we'd use synchronize everywhere. And when you use synchronize, normally I recommend as a first step is to encapsulate your locking. When you encapsulate your locking, it gives you the freedom to later on change the way that you do your locking. Because in Java 5 and 6 and 7, we've got lock and read-write lock. Or atomic integer, you might want to do it a different way internally. In Java 8, you've got stamped lock that you can use for doing the locking. And when I mean encapsulate, you can see here, I've made the lock private. That's always my first attempt. My first step is to make the lock private, because that allows me later on to make it an atomic integer, or to use read-write lock, or to use reentrant lock. And reentrant lock has some benefits over synchronized, but there are also some problems. How many of you have used reentrant lock? Ooh, okay. How many of you have discovered some of the race conditions with reentrant lock? Some of you, okay. Right, well done. I always expected reentrant lock to be fairly safe and as good as synchronized, but it's not, right? There are quite a few bugs which have been discovered in the reentrant lock, and a lot of them have been taken out in Java 8, but use at your own caution, or probably don't use. The only time you really want to use it is if you need the additional functionality, like being able to interrupt, being able to try lock, but besides those, it's not a good idea to use it. So the way that you would structure the code is like this. You'd have a deposit would be, for example, lock.lock, try, balance plus equals amount, and finally lock.unlock. That's sort of the recommended way of doing things. However, even that, people often get that wrong, and they end up with slightly wrong code, which doesn't always unlock. So you end up with deadlocks. And of course, as I mentioned already, there are race conditions inside reentrant lock. So you can get a situation where the lock is available, but there's still a thread which is blocked on trying to acquire the lock which is available, for example. There are lots of different scenarios like that where you can go horribly wrong. Now, when Java 5 was released, reentrant lock was significantly faster than synchronized. And so people started using that because it was faster. It's not a good idea to do anything because it's faster. Right? It's a bit like choosing where you want to live because that's where you pay less tax. A lot of Greeks are doing that at the moment. They're coming to live in Bulgaria because you pay less tax here at the moment, right? But you're a part of the EU, so don't worry. Soon you'll also be paying like 50% tax. Don't worry. It's coming. It's coming. It's not there, but it's coming soon. Coming near you very soon. So you move your whole family to Sofia, and you set up a business here, and then say, oh, no, we also want to have more tax. So you end up with, now where do you go, you know? Back to Greece, whatever, you know? It's sort of. So in the same way, if you make a choice only based on performance, you often make the wrong choices. Right. Now, another one interesting one is read-write lock. This differentiates between reading and writing. It's a good idea if you have a lot of reading, a long read block. There's a bug, though, in Java, in the reentrant read-write lock, and that is you can get starvation. If you have a single reader and lots of writers, you can get starvation on the reader. So the reader never gets to read. But that's the only way. Besides that, it's actually okay. And of course, as I mentioned in Java 8, you've got the stamped lock. So basically, you just differentiate between reading and writing. We normally say that you need to have at least 2,000 code instructions for the reading to be worth your while to use reading, read-write lock. Okay, the micromanager, the law of the micromanager. So this one manages and controls with excessive attention to minor details. It's like a boss who tells you exactly how to do GitHub. You know, you must do it this way. But there are lots of ways to do it. But no, you must do it his way. And no other way is good except for his way. That's a very annoying boss to have. Look for another boss. You're all going to leave your work by the end of this talk. So threat contention is quite difficult to spot, because what happens is you see that your performance is not great, but it doesn't matter what you throw at the system, your CPU is still not being used. So your CPU is sitting idle, but you're also not scaling, right? And you see that your disk isn't busy, your network's not busy, your garbage collector's not even doing anything. It's like 0.1% GC, CPU is at 4%, and you still can't scale. When you get to that situation, have a look at thread contention. One example that somebody found in production code was this. We had somebody decided that string would be a great object to lock on, to have synchronized on. So they put in a constant string, and then they said synchronize on the string. Right? Now the problem is with this idea, and please don't do this, it's at the top, don't do this. Right? Please don't do this. It's a very bad idea, because what happened now is they used this throughout their program, and completely unrelated pieces of code were blocking each other out. Okay? You can find contention with thread dumps. Thread dumps will show you. But you need to look a bit. They're not always that obvious to find. Another example that I had, I'm just going to mention this, was Red Hat, JBoss server. I was doing a course for them, and they had a problem that their performance was good, and then all of a sudden it went bad, and it stayed bad. Right? So it was great, and then juked down, and it stayed on there. So it wasn't that bad, but it was worse. It was like from 100% down to 80%. And they couldn't get their CPUs to use 100% anymore after it dipped down like that. And they couldn't understand it. It's like, why? It's great, then it goes worse, and then it stays bad. And eventually, we discovered that they were losing semaphores. So they were acquiring semaphores, weren't releasing them anymore. And so they were simply having less threads being able to use the database at the same time. And as a result, it went droop down, and then it stayed on there. You could see it in the thread dump, because you could see that there were more threads waiting on semaphores after the problem than before. The answer is always in your thread dump, but it's not always easy to find, because often you've got hundreds of threads inside your thread dump. So here's one class, atomic integer. It's thread-safe without explicitly locking. So this is the code that used to be used up to Java 7 in order to do the compare and set on your value. So basically what it does is we read the current value, work out the next value, and then we try to set it if it's equal to a certain value. If it's equal, that's great. If it's not equal, then we try again. And we keep on trying until we eventually have success with getting through. This is the code that you'll see in Java 5 up to and including Java 7. All right? If you run this code on my laptop, you're going to notice that the performance is really bad in comparison to something like, for example, synchronized. It's worse than synchronized, this particular code, if you don't test it in the right way. If you do lots and lots and lots and lots of add and gets, you'll notice that this is worse. Because what happens is that with the new chip architectures, the probability of a clash is much higher, and you end up with doing repeat, 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 and never actually, or taking a long time to get out. So what they did was in Java 8, they changed this algorithm a bit So now they do that with unsafe. So you can do this directly, much closer to the hardware, doing this add and get. And as a result, now it's really fast, much, much faster. And so here's my bank account, which Atomics. So basically, deposit simply says add and get, and get balance returns the int value. All right, Cretan driving. I was speaking to this one American lady. They have an American army base on Crete, so she was there, and she was going back to America because she couldn't handle Crete. She was driving the speed limit. You don't do that. I mean, you know, I've noticed here, you also do that here, but they also don't do it there, right? She was driving the speed limit, and there's somebody right behind her the whole time. And then she got to a stop sign, and she stopped. I mean, she stopped. Come on, man, seriously. There's nothing there. There's nobody around, you know? She stopped. And of course, the person crashed into her, you know? So, you know, it's a... Now, the fun part about Crete is they've got all these rules, and they don't really enforce them. So they've got like rules like you have to wear seatbelts. They also have a rule you have to wear a crash helmet when you ride a motorbike. Do they have it in Bulgaria? You have to wear a crash helmet, yeah? Except they didn't specify where you have to wear the crash helmet. Okay, you just have to wear it, right? So in some ways, see all the Greeks with the helmet on their elbow. So if they fall down, the elbow is fine, right? But their head is like smashed up, right? Now the challenge with Crete is they don't put up speed signs. You don't actually know what the speed limit is. You ask a Cretan, what's the speed there? I don't know, 100. You know, so I was driving along the road and got a speed fine. I was going, I don't know, something, 86. I thought it was a 90 zone. Turns out it was a 70 zone. I think. Nobody knows. So I've got all these signs, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. And people get confused with these signs. They say, you know what, I'm just going to go in the middle, you know. And here's a tractor coming from the wrong side of the road, off the highway, you know. You're like, what's going on with this place, you know. And because they don't enforce the rules, you don't know when you're doing something wrong, you know. You go to Germany, or no, Switzerland, go to Switzerland, you exceed the speed limit by 1 kilometer, and you're getting a fine. That's it. In Crete, it's like, how fast is it? Oh, I don't know, you know, 70, 80, you know, 90, 150, you know. You ask the guy, what's the speed limit on the highway? Well, where the cameras are, they're at 70. Everywhere else, no, there's no limit. Okay, right. So they've got these crazy rules in the virtual machine. They say, that VM implements, if you're writing a virtual machine, avoid splitting your 64-bit values where possible. Okay, so that means if I'm writing a virtual machine, I'm actually allowed to split 64-bit values. So if I write along, I can write it in two operations, if I want to. I'm allowed to. And then programmers are encouraged to declare shared 64-bit values as volatile, all synchronize their programs correctly to avoid this. This is in the Java memory model. And so this means that if I've got a class like this, we've got a private long value, and if I set in a get, and if I set it with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, A, B, C, D, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, or 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, then besides the obvious answers, I can also get mixed values back on a 32-bit machine. And I've tried that, and it does actually happen. Now imagine trying to debug a program where that's happened, your double is coming back wrong. I was speaking to a large bank a few months ago, and I was talking about, you know, obviously you're not going to use double for currency. And these guys say, but we do. We always use double for currency. I mean, what else do you use for currency? I'm not telling you. If you need to ask, and you're not supposed to know. So they're using that, and of course, if they've got a concurrency bug, this can really hurt you. Now, the reason why they have this is to give freedom to the virtual machine implementers and to the hardware guys using it. But it also makes it difficult to write 100% correct Java, because if your code works on your machine, it doesn't mean it's actually correct. You might run it on better hardware, faster hardware, and it might break. You've got to synchronize at the right places. If you have too much synchronization, you end up with contention. Not enough synchronization, you get corrupt data. You might get fields written early. if you want to have everything as read-only and immutable, you end up with GC problems. So in every way, this is not a simple problem. How many of you would like to win the lottery? Do you have a lottery in Bulgaria? Some of you play the lottery. All of you would put up your hands. You need to go for maths class now. Okay. Now, so we all want to win the lottery. Okay. Do you know those emails you get from Nigeria where they say, I'm so glad I got hold of you. You inherited some money. We once got one of those emails from somebody. And this was a long time ago. It was many years ago. And we believed it. And you know what? It was true. We actually got money from, inherited money, my wife did, from somebody that she'd never met who was living in America. So just check your spam folder and just double check. It does happen. It does. I promise you it happened. It happened to us. All right. So, now you would think that having all of a sudden this windfall of money or resources is going to make things better. But it rarely does. Most of the time when you have a sudden windfall, it makes things worse, right? And so the example here was one system that I worked on, then an old system, they replaced with a new system, and all of a sudden, the system started falling over. And I was helping some friends of mine who were consultants for that company, and they said to me, what have you changed? We haven't changed anything. We just took the old system, put it onto the new server, and it's falling over. And what happened was because they had faster hardware, better hardware, the faults also appeared more quickly. Now, we all know what happens when you can't log onto the server occasionally. We restart it, right? We restart. We say, oh, it doesn't work, restart. And then you see, does it work? No, yeah, it works now. Okay, good. Everything's fine. Okay? But in reality, what happened now was because we had faster hardware, it didn't happen once a year, it happened twice, three, four times a week. On Fridays, when all the guys were printing out the customer reports. Okay? And it was a very simple problem. First of all, we in order to verify that there was this problem, I put a synchronized block around the entire subsystem. Everything was synchronous, was single-threaded. The whole subsystem was single-threaded, right? Because they had this black box sort of subsystem inside there. And the problem immediately went away, right? And so that sort of proved that that was the problem. And then what we do is we found where the problem was coming from. It was a DOM tree getting corrupted. There was some DOM tree they had in there. And so what we did was whenever we returned a node from the DOM tree, we returned a deep clone of that node. So we made a copy of the node. This was the second law, third law I showed you. And that's the problem then magically went away with 12 characters of Java code. How many of you have tried lutefisk? Nobody. You guys are not very brave. How many of you know what lutefisk is? Ah, Attila knows. But you haven't tried it yet. You've got to try it, Attila. You will never want to eat ever again. So uneaten lutefisk looks a bit like this. Okay, it is actually fish, right? It doesn't taste as good as it looks. Okay? And it's basically, you must imagine a Viking father insisting that his stubborn child eats its lutefisk, right? So this is a law of uneaten lutefisk. And it's this fish they have in Norway. Anything from Norway, fish, just avoid it. Don't have it, okay? But now that I've told you about it, you've got to try it once in your life, then you never have to try it again, right? It's horrible. It's basically fish soaked in lye, soap water, for 2 weeks. It's just too terrible. So part of the program stops responding. You might have a GUI that doesn't repaint anymore, can't log in anymore, and it's always you've got at least two threads wanting what the other ones has. Neither's willing to give up their side. It's a bit like Greece and the Troika at the moment. So we've got happy locker, we've got the final object lock inside, and I've got a synchronized method void f, and I synchronize the lock as well. Then I've got a method g where I synchronize lock and I call f. Now, you can see easily what happens that thread A calls f, gets this lock, thread B calls g, gets the lock, and now thread B wants to call f, but he can't because this is not available, and similarly thread A wants to get the lock, which he can't because it's held by thread B. This is an obvious deadlock. Now, if you're lucky, you'll see it inside your thread dump. You won't always find it there, though. Sometimes you have to scratch through the thread dump to find it. It's not always that obvious what the problem is. Deadlockers can be found with JSTACK. So JSTACK minus L is a good one, because it also shows the Java 5 locks. But the best way is to avoid it from the beginning. You can resolve it if it's a Java 5 lock, reentrant lock, but it's not a good idea. Avoid it in the first place. So I've come to the end of my talk. Threading is a lot easier when you know the rules. I've got lots of free articles on my newsletter. Subscribe to that. I've got some really fun courses, which I do over here. So if you're interested, join us. Also do in-house courses. And that's my email address, heinz@javaspecialists.eu. Any questions? Okay, so I'll repeat the question. The question is, how was I comparing atomic integer versus synchronized? So I don't know if you, I'd said it very carefully. I said, depending how you measure, if you write a very naive test, you'll notice that it will appear as if atomic integer is really slow, even in comparison to synchronized. Performance or what? Okay, so for performance, you want to use something like JMH, Java Micro Benchmarking Harness. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. If you don't test it the right way, yes, yes, absolutely. I've got a newsletter on it. Absolutely. So depending on how you test it, it all depends on how you write the test. If you make a mistake in your test, it'll appear as if atomic integer is miles slower than synchronized.
I'm GMH
for a long time. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll tell you the story about JMH. You'll enjoy that story, but I won't tell it in public here. Any other questions?
Okay, my question is, you said for active threads per core, hyper-threaded core or actual core?
Yeah. I'm going to answer just like that because
I don't get the joke.
It really depends. You're going to use a response of your system as a guide, and you need to look at lots of factors. You also have to look at what other processes run in the machines. It's a whole big decision on how many threads. If you take for example the way that Java does it and turn it down Java 8, they take the easy way. They just say one thread per hyperthread or per hardware thread. That's what they do. But that's also often not the right number. So that's configuration. The one thing I want to add to that is you should always make the thread pool configurable in size. Because otherwise what can easily happen is that you set a size and it just isn't appropriate for your particular system. In that case, you want to be able to change it easily without changing code.
Why shouldn't I synchronize on this?
Well, if you're synchronizing on this, if you synchronize on this, you actually are, you're not encapsulating your locking. Once you've synchronized on this, you've made it public what you're locking on. And anybody else can be participating in your locking strategy. If that's what you want to do, then that's fine. But as a first step, you might not want to do that. You might want to keep it private. And as a next step, if you later on want to open up, then you can open it up. But to open up from the beginning, then you've made it public. And you can't then take that away, because then somebody else might depend on that.
Thank you.
Okay, so the question was, is it a good idea to have every single object as a lock? Of course not. It's a really, really bad idea, but that's what we're stuck with, right? Alexander.
All of this depends on the Java memory model. How do you go around really understanding it?
The Java memory model?
Yeah.
Nobody understands that. It's quite funny, because you have these discussions on the concurrency interest mailing list. And somebody will ask a question like, why can't constructors be synchronized? And then it ends up with like 100 messages about people explaining why it should happen, why it shouldn't happen. The problem is with the memory model is that it's really just a description of what should happen, but in many cases there's not really a, you can't prove anything. You can't prove that this is correct, right? So you can't prove that this is how it's supposed to work. Because if you write a piece of code that proves that a certain aspect of memory model is actually in fact in a certain way, it could be that the VM that you're running on has a bug. So you don't know. The VM has lots of bugs. And the compiler too.
Can I say something?
Yes, sure.
So, you know Shipilet?
Sorry?
Shipilet.
Yes, of course.
So there is a great blog post there. All right, so.
Okay, I will.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yes.
Do you know that Java is the fastest language in the world? Do you know that? Now, Java is the fastest. Java can do an infinite loop within a second. Why are you laughing? Oh, I'm serious. I'm serious. You think I'm joking? I'm not joking. So just the last thing before we're supposed to be on tea time already. We are very fast java.java. So public class very fast Java. Public static void main string args. Okay, now let's write an infinite loop. I'll do it like this. For int I equals naught, I is less than integer dot max value, I plus equals 2. Line I. Okay, now we have 2 to the 31 minus 1 numbers. So we go up to integer max value minus 1. We then say plus 2, and we go to minus 2 to the 31. And then we keep on going up to 0, and then up to, and we keep on going round and round like that. So it goes, it's an infinite loop, all right? This is infinite loop in Java. Okay? Java C, very fast Java. Java, very fast Java. Done. Isn't that brilliant? Pardon, sorry? It's less than a second. No, there it is. You can see it's less than a second. Less than a second. Boom. Thank you.